Good evening. On behalf of Vanderbilt University's Martin Luther King Jr. Committee, welcome to the opening performances preceding this evening's keynote address by Michelle Alexander. My name is Pastor Gretchen Pearson. I serve as Associate University Chaplain. We have enjoyed a magnificent MLK Day today, and a wonderful evening is still ahead. So again, welcome, and thank you for coming. We are so glad that you are here. I also want to offer special thanks to all who have made this evening possible, including essay winners and their families, singers and conductors, those responsible for logistics, setup, lights, sound, publicity, those who have prepared and served food, all who have led teach-ins and discussions today, MLK committee members, the Black Cultural Center, and the Office of Religious Life. Please join me now in welcoming to the stage the Blair Chamber Choir, conducted by Dr. Tucker Biddlecombe, followed by Voices of Praise, Victory A Cappella, and Jeremiah Generation.
There's a great camp meeting.
There's a great camp meeting.
Oh, walk on, my children, don't you get weary. Walk on, my children, don't you get a weary. Just a walk on, my children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Oh, walk on, my children, don't you get weary. Walk on, my children, don't you get a weary. Just a walk on, my children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Walk on, a walk on, and never tire. Walk 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 and never tire. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Oh, walk together, children, don't you get weary. Walk on, my children, don't you get a weary. Just a walk together, children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Sing and sing and never tire. 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 There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Oh, walk on, my children, don't you get weary. Walk on, my children, don't you get a weary. Just a walk on, my children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land.
Lord,
shout, Lord, shout, Lord, shout, Lord, and never tire. Shout 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 and never tire. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. Oh, walk together, children, don't you get weary. Sing on, my children, don't you get a weary. Just a shout together, children, don't you get weary. There's a great, yes, a great, there's a great camp meeting in the promised land.
Stand on the line. Yeah. Good evening, y'all. My name's Frank Dobson. I'm director of the Bishop Joseph Johnson Black Cultural Center and one of the co-chairs for this Martin Luther King celebration. Every year, we honor the memory of Martin Luther King by not only having wonderful workshops and forums and discussions on campus and also participating in the march as part of the community, but we also sponsor an essay and poetry contest for young people in the Nashville community. And I'm very pleased that in back of me are four wonderful young people from middle school and also high school who'll be reciting their winning work. I'm going to call them in the order in which they will proceed. Adric W. Kimbrough Jr. from Overbrook School is our second place winner. Elizabeth Kimbrough from Overbrook School is our first place winner. Both of those are from middle school. From high school, for first place, we had a tie. Brittany Pascal from MNPS Middle College High School, and also Caitlin Killian from Spring Hill High School. And they will be reciting their work in the honor, in the order in which I just called them. So first will be Adric Kimbrough.
Hello, my name is Adric Kimbrough, and the title of my speech is Let Freedom Ring. Let Freedom Ring. I have a dream that freedom will ring throughout our land. My dream is rooted in the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who had a dream that one day people would not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. We may be different, but we are all human, and every human deserves to be free and wants to be free. Let freedom ring. Freedom is not for blacks only, white only, rich only, or poor only, or man only. Freedom is for everyone. The purpose of freedom is to let dreams come true, so that in the city of Nashville, the state of Tennessee, and even the United States of America can become a better place. Without freedom, we cannot welcome the stranger, clothe the naked, or feed the hungry. Without freedom, we cannot vote for president of the United States of America. And most importantly, without freedom, we cannot live out the American dream of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Langston Hughes wrote, "What happens to a dream deferred? Does it drop like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Or does it hang like a, or does it stink like rotten meat, or custard sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Or maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? My dream is that the American dream of freedom does not explode or come up empty for the poor person, the person who cannot afford health care, the person who does not speak English, or the father who struggles to feed his family. Let them hear freedom ring." Many people often question my dream of becoming a professional golfer because they refer to golf as a white sport. Golf is a sport. Anybody can play. And in fact, Tiger Woods has stayed the number one golfer in the world longer than any other golfer. We cannot limit what we can do based on what we look like or what we have. We deserve to play any sport, hold any position, be any profession, even if it is if we want to be the president of the United States of America, if that is what we want to do. The sky is the limit. Let freedom ring. I have a dream today. Freedom will ring if we are willing to work together. This unity is an obstacle standing in the way of each of us being able to let freedom ring. The truth is, we are all in this together. We cannot be free until every one of us believes that each one deserves to be free. Like the three musketeers, we must be united, we stand, but divided, we all fall. We are one body. As President Obama expressed while receiving a second victory, a president of the United States, when the blacks joined to the whites, the Asian to the Native American, the rich to the poor, the gay with the straight, and yes, even the Democrat with the Republican. We will be more than just a collection of red states and blue states. We are, and forever will be, the United States of America. The only way we can join together is to love one another. Let freedom ring. Everyone should have the opportunity to get a good education. Everyone should have a chance to raise their children, and everyone should have a fair shake at getting a job. and everyone should be able to live in a safe place, and everyone should be able to go to a doctor. This is freedom. So let freedom ring in every school. Let freedom ring in every university, whether it is the blue and white of TSU or the black and gold of Vanderbilt University. Let freedom ring from the Bethlehem Centers of Nashville to Montgomery Bell Academy. Let freedom ring from Casey Holmes to Bell Mead. Let freedom ring from Baptist Hospital to Meharry General Hospital. Let freedom ring!
My name is Elizabeth Kimbrough, and my speech is called The Pathway to Freedom. National statistics show that homicide is the second leading cause of death among youth ages 10 to 24, and that 650,843 young people ages 10 to 24 were treated in emergency departments for non-fatal injuries sustained from assaults. Locally, the number of my peers in the Nashville juvenile court system for violent crimes is on the rise. I believe that my generation has the ability to change these statistics. We have the power to burst the bubbles that makes us think violence is the answer. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the only pathway to freedom is nonviolence. The leaders of the civil rights movement, including Dr. King, did not resort to violence because it would result in the loss of life. They utilized love as an alternate solution to violence. They strategized and used nonviolence to make change in our community, including marches, boycotts, sit-in demonstrations, and prayer meetings. One of the main ways civil rights leaders resolved these problems was using their minds to negotiate solutions. They tried to communicate and come up with answers that would benefit both sides. Tactics like Rosa Parks refusing to move to the back of the bus burst bubbles of segregation in buses and in the voting polls. Civil rights activists fought back without using physical blows. They used nonviolence to gain freedom for African Americans. Instead of using fists to fight back, the Freedom Riders fought back with nonviolent resistance. They were trained how to protect themselves and not use physical violence. Boycotters, marchers, and churchgoers used nonviolence to fight against being spit on, called names, sprayed with water hoses, and dogs attacking them. Attending church, praying, and singing songs gave them the strength to keep on the pathway to freedom. My generation can learn a lot from Dr. King, Diane Nash, Fannie Lou Hamer, and Representative John Lewis on how not to fight back without using violence. They taught us that our power is not how hard we can hit or whether we can beat someone down. It is the power to love. We still face equal but not equal schools and housing, racism, and being stereotyped for the color of our skin or for what we are wearing. Division, hate, and anger in my generation often results in unnecessary violence. Like the protesters, we too can fight back without a fist, gun, or knife. Fight back by getting an education, not by joining a gang. Fight back by getting a job, not by robbing a bank. Fight back by attending church, not by swearing at your homeboy's house. And most importantly, fight back by keeping Dr. King's dream alive, not by letting all his hard work go to waste. I believe if my peers are willing to speak out against the wrongs, bullying will stop. I believe that if my friends would join together and use their minds to strategize about bringing racial harmony in our schools and communities, we would be the example of how people can come together regardless of whether they are black or white, Hispanic or Asian, male or female, gay or straight, Christian or Muslim, rich or poor. There would be no need to be a Crip or a Blood. Instead of Generation X, we would be Generation C, the generation of change. A famous writer said, "To change the world, you must first change yourself." Michael Jackson said, If you want to make the world a better place, you must start with the man in the mirror. Well, I'm going to start with this woman in the mirror. Elizabeth Adria Kimbrough. I am going to be the change that I want others to be. I'm going to speak out against injustice. I'm going to learn all I can learn so that I can be all I can be. I am going to help others. I'm going to love everybody. I am going to keep Dr. King's dream alive. I am going to stay on the pathway to freedom.
Good evening. I'm Brittany Pascal, and the title of my essay is The Presence of Justice, Bursting My Silent Bubbles. From my 17 years of existence, I have learned how easy it is to live in our silent bubbles. It all started before I even realized it. For instance, the mumbles and stares of older family members as two men holding hands pass by. Perhaps the swiftness of a Caucasian parent moving her child away from me at the playground. Naturally, when I inquired about these situations, I was told that it was nothing. And fortunately, I have now realized that it is and was indeed something, and that the same mumbles lead to prejudice, avoidance, and even genocide. They, in fact, aid in the creation of our silent bubbles. Silent bubbles that drive human beings to hate, isolate, and fear because of who they love, what they are, or for who they are. While I could go on and on about the existence and creation of silent bubbles, the true task at hand is determining what you and I can do about it. Bursting the silent bubbles will take a variety of things, including asking the hard questions, educating ourselves, redefining justice, and having the personal willingness and commitment to live outside of our own silent bubbles. Asking the hard questions is essential in bursting our silent bubbles. See, it all starts with asking something as simple as why. Why do I think this, or why am I ashamed of this? Not only will asking the hard questions deepen our personal growth, but these questions will allow us to become less complacent inside of our bubbles. It is only after we ask these questions that we can begin to search for the answers to burst our silent bubbles. Though this point seems cliche, education for ourselves and others is critical. Education may be as formal as a diversity relations seminar or as informal as engaging in dialogue with someone of a different race, gender, or socioeconomic class. Education also means accepting the fact that we are all teachers and that what we teach is up to us. Regardless of the setting, education will help us realize the limiting lenses that our silent bubbles place over our lives. The most important step to relinquishing our silent bubbles is having the willingness to change and embark on the journey for the presence of justice. First, we must redefine our meaning of justice. This is a very personal part of each person's journey. For me, justice is no longer what the law states or what non-Supreme Court justices decide. Justice is the right to live my life as who I truly am, which takes my willingness to change how I previously lived my life in my silent bubble. After we redefine our definition of justice, we must act on it, thus creating the presence of justice. We cannot stop here at the creation, for it is where the journey begins. Now, it will take commitment and dedication to continue our lives in the presence of justice. It is easy to hide any evidence of our true identities from the world, especially in today's fast-paced society. However, I am convinced that this is not the life that we are called to live. Living this life is realizing that I am a human being with needs, living in a world of other human beings with needs like power, knowledge, belonging, freedom, fun, and survival. It is knowing that my bursting my own silent bubbles liberates others to do the same. Lastly, it is accepting and acting on the fact that no part of us was ever meant to be placed in a bubble in the first place. I am a student, a daughter, a friend, a writer, a lover, and sometimes a fighter. A heterosexual, African-American, able-bodied, young, Christian, middle-class woman who is on a journey. A journey that has been risky, scary, and even uncomfortable. One that has brought tears, laughter, freedom, friendship, love, victory, and even defeat. A journey of asking the hard questions, educating myself and others, a journey for the presence of justice. My journey does not make me who I am. My journey is who I am, and for that, I am eternally grateful. Will you join me on this journey or continue to live your life in a bubble?
My name is Caitlin Killian, and the title of my poem is A Child Bursts Bubbles in the Air. A child bursts bubbles in the air, too young to vocalize his thoughts, too young to care. A mere infant, unprejudiced, unaware. Unaware that because he was born black, he'll always be labeled a criminal. Unaware that his color classifies him stereotypical. Society still focuses on his pigment rather than the individual. A child bursts bubbles in the air, believes she's a princess, a crown in her hair. Completely oblivious to what the media blares. It blares that if she's overweight, she's not good enough. It blares she must starve herself to correct her bluff. It will make this princess believe she's ugly, but the media won't acknowledge that it's corrupt. A child bursts bubbles in the air, practically a baby, can't comprehend what is fair. This baby cries because his brother's blood has been shed everywhere. Everywhere his brother went, he was bullied for play. His brother was ostracized because he was labeled gay. His brother decided his life wasn't worth it. His brother committed suicide today. Society will discriminate for anything that you are. No matter how well you're doing, you'll never be up to par. Nearly 40 years ago, a man had a dream to eliminate racism, change his current scene. Why then in hatred are we still bound? When will we tear the walls of discrimination down? A child bursts bubbles in the air, many years from now, with no more walls to tear. The weight of injustice they will no longer have to bear. Their world is a blank slate to be filled by pure imagination, because we, as Americans, chose to end segregation, because we, as Americans, united as one nation.
Thank you again, young people. You make us proud. Thank you. From the mouth of babes, indeed. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce and present the leader of Vanderbilt University, Chancellor Nick Zeppos. And as he's coming forward, I'd like to say again that this sort of thing doesn't happen without commitment from leadership at the top. And indeed, we're so blessed to have someone as Nick Zeppos as our leader, Chancellor Zeppos.
Thank you very much, Frank, for that very warm and kind introduction. And I want to welcome everybody to this wonderful Martin Luther King Jr. commemorative keynote address. We've had so many great activities today, and this surely, for many of us, will be a highlight for the Vanderbilt community, for our broader community, and I think this day and all the events is certainly a transformative event for our nation as well. At Vanderbilt, we really join in as a community to honor the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And as I said bright and early this morning to the youngsters that I was going to march with, we do this by not having a day off, but having a day in. And while we are not formally in classes today, like any great college or university, we find the outside of the classroom experience to be a time for reflection, discourse, and further discovery. It is a day that many of us have participated in the activities, but I really have to commend the students for their leadership. And at a great university, it's really the students who lead by example, and we tend to follow. The students and others have been part of the annual citywide march. I was privileged to be part of that. I was carrying the briefcase of Coach James Franklin in that march, holding his coat while I was getting his picture taken with everybody. And I finally said, "I sign his paycheck." And they said, "Okay, you can get in the picture." But it was really extraordinary to be part of that. Then, of course, we had lunchtime roundtables and teach-ins. And then we had an important commemoration of the Nashville Freedom Ride, something that we should always keep front and center, considering the pivotal role that Nashville played in the civil rights movement. And, of course, this keynote address. But my time is limited, and I'd like to turn this over to two wonderful student leaders. I want to turn this podium over to Kirsten Christfield, our Multicultural Leadership Council president, and Mary Claire Menard, our Vanderbilt Student Government president, who will offer a formal introduction of Michelle Alexander, our keynote speaker. Thank you all for coming.
Hello and good evening, everyone. Thank you again for joining us here tonight. As Chancellor Zepos, I'm in one of his classes, so I can say that. As Chancellor Zepos mentioned, I'm Mary Claire Manard, and I currently serve as the student body president for Vanderbilt University. Tonight, I'm up here with a good friend and classmate, Kirsten Christfield, who currently serves as the president for the Multicultural Leadership Council here at Vanderbilt. And we have the distinct honor of introducing to you all our keynote speaker for this evening, Professor Michelle Alexander. I personally cannot think of a better way to conclude our day of commemorating Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. than by introducing one of our own, a Vanderbilt alum, to share her wisdom, experiences, and hopes for the future. But before we introduce our esteemed guest of honor for this evening, I would like to take this moment to thank all of those individuals and university-wide departments who made today possible. In particular, the MLK committee co-chaired by Pastor Gretchen Pearson and Dr. Frank Dobson. This commemorative series was established in 1985 at Vanderbilt University as a celebration of the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The university affirms its own commitment to the goals of peace and racial justice to which Dr. King dedicated his life through this year's theme titled, The Presence of Justice, Bursting the Silent Bubbles. Michelle Alexander completed her undergrad at Vanderbilt, go Doors, and then went on to Stanford Law School. Following law school, she clerked for Justice Harry A. Blackmun on the United States Supreme Court and for Chief Judge Abner Mikva on the United States Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. She was Associate Professor of Law at Stanford Law School, where she directed the Civil Rights Clinics before she accepted her current appointment. Michelle Alexander has left her mark in the civil rights community as a lawyer, advocate, and legal scholar. She currently holds a joint appointment at the Kerwin Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity and the Moritz College of Law at The Ohio State University.
Today, her work draws from the lessons learned in her previous career as a civil rights lawyer and advocate in both the private and public sector. For several years, she helped lead a national campaign against racial profiling when she served as the director of the Racial Justice Project for the ACLU of Northern California. While an associate at Saperstein, Goldstein, Demchak, and Baller, she specialized in plaintiff-side class action lawsuits alleging race and gender discrimination. But you all may know her best for her book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. Michelle Alexander's best-selling book deals with the current levels of mass incarceration of African-American males in the country today. This issue, along with other forms of societal oppression, have major social consequences for America's future. Alexander's research focuses on proving that the U.S. criminal justice system has continued to practice traditional and new forms of discrimination in this day and age. The book has sold over 175,000 copies and made it onto the New York Times bestseller list for 10 consecutive months. Along with other rave reviews and being featured in numerous national media outlets, her book has also received the 2011 NAACP Image Award for Best Nonfiction. With the attention from her book, Alexander wants to move the issue of incarceration to the forefront of the agenda for the civil rights community. So please join me in welcoming our esteemed keynote speaker for this evening as she shares her goals of equal opportunity in America for all, Professor Michelle Alexander.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for that incredibly warm welcome and kind introduction. I am delighted to be here, absolutely thrilled to be here, returning to my alma mater and to join with you in this wonderful celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life and his legacy. These types of gatherings are always important, but today is truly historic. Today, on this very day, our nation's first black president, Barack Obama, was sworn in for his second term. And, yep. And equally remarkable, this year marks the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. 50 years. Yes, 50 years have passed since King's voice soared over the Washington monuments declaring his dream. I have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. And watching President Obama's inaugural address today, I could hear echoes of King's speech and his dream. I have a dream. And it left me wondering, as I clicked off the television, are all of us, truly all of us, each and every one of us, welcome to share in this dream, the same dream that Dr. King dreamed? Most Americans by now can recite some portion of Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech. It's an extraordinary and very familiar speech. I've grown accustomed to hearing clips from the speech played over and over again on the radio every January, recycled clips, the very same clips over and over again. There are the favorite quotes, the favorite lines that get repeated. And now that I have school-age children, I see how King is explained to them in classrooms. Back when I was in elementary school, there was no Martin Luther King holiday, no Martin Luther King Day, no discussions of his heroism in classrooms. But just the other day, my children came home telling me all they had learned about King's courage and all that he had done for this nation. He was the man who stood up to the bullies, the man who believed children of all colors and walks of life should be able to hold hands and be judged by the content of their character and not the color of their skin. He was willing to die, they told me, so that we could live his dream today. And I found myself conflicted as I listened to my children parrot back to me what they'd heard in school about this man who believed in kindness and forgiveness and compassion and justice and fairness for all. They say, yes, yes, all of that is true. That's true. But I felt uneasy. I know something has been lost in the translation. That sense of disorientation was crystallized for me recently when I read Vincent Harding's insightful book, Martin Luther King, The Inconvenient Hero. Dr. Harding was one of King's closest friends and advisors, marching with him countless times and living around the corner from King's family in Atlanta. And Dr. Harding writes with some real sorrow, quote, "It appears as if the price for the first national holiday honoring a black man is the development of a massive case of national amnesia concerning who that black man really was. I would suggest that we Americans have chosen amnesia rather than continue King's painful, uncharted, and often disruptive struggle toward a more perfect union," end quote. It appears, he says, as if we are determined to hold our new hero captive to the powerful period of his life that culminated in the magnificent March on Washington in 1963, refusing to allow him to break out beyond the stunning eloquence of his I Have a Dream speech. Dr. Harding writes, quote, "We would like to forget that it was not the weaver of gentle, sunny dreams of freedom who was shot down on a balcony in Memphis, Tennessee," end quote. He was, by 1968, a different, even more courageous man, a man ahead of his time. And I can see clearly now that on days like today, we rarely honor the man who died. No, we honor the more sunny, cheerful version of him. We honor the man who gave the soaring speech about black and white school children, the man who dreamed an integrationist dream. But who was Dr. King 5 years later? In 1968, who was that man killed on a motel balcony? The man who was marching with sanitation workers, demanding economic justice, not mere civil rights. The man who had come to believe after the civil rights battles had already been won, after the major civil rights victories had already been won, that our biggest battles, the most important battles, still lie ahead, and that nothing short of a radical restructuring of our society held any hope for making the dream and promise of America a reality for all its citizens. King explained to a reporter in 1967, quote, "For years I labored with the idea of reforming the existing institutions of the society, a little change here, a little change there. Now I feel quite differently. I think you've got to have a reconstruction of the entire society, a revolution of values," end quote. Frustrated by white resistance to addressing in any meaningful way decaying ghettos, failing schools, structural joblessness, and crippling poverty, he told his staff at the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, quote, "The dispossessed of this nation, the poor, both white and Negro, live in a cruelly unjust society. They must organize a revolution against that injustice, not against the lives of their fellow citizens, but against the structures through which the society is refusing to lift the load of poverty." So what would King think of us today, the world we have created in his absence? Would he believe that the nonviolent revolution he dreamed of had been won, had even begun? The revolution of values he prayed for? What if he could see us today? Would he believe that we share his dream? That we are now traveling the road that he was marching? 50 years later, have we caught up with King yet? Are we finally on the path that he was traveling in 1963, 1968? Back in 1969, while blood still stained the motel balcony where Dr. King was murdered, a poem was written honoring his life and reflecting on his death. The poem was written back when King had only just begun the process of being transformed in our collective consciousness from a troublesome, dangerous black figure to a national hero. It was written way back when the memory of King's assassination was still fresh, the tears still spilling among those who loved him. Back then, in 1969, the poet Carl Wendell Himes Jr. penned this poem reflecting on King's death. He wrote, "Now that he is safely dead, let us praise him, build monuments to his glory, sing hosannas to his name. Dead men make such convenient heroes. They cannot rise to challenge the images we would fashion from their lives. And besides, it is easier to build monuments than to make a better world. So now that he is safely dead, we, with eased consciences, will teach our children that he was a great man, knowing that the cause for which he lived is still a cause, and the dream for which he died is still a dream, a dead man's dream." Now that he is safely dead, Martin Luther King Jr., safely dead, is it true? Is he and his dream safely dead? Now, I know many people in this room would say, no, his spirit is very much alive. It is still living among all of us. It is thriving right here in this room. And what better evidence could there be of that fact than that we are all here today, right here, right now, honoring his dream, a national federal holiday. Think about that. a national federal holiday for Martin Luther King Jr., the man who was deemed a threat to national security by the FBI, a radical troublemaker. Is it not obvious that we as a nation have finally caught up to King? We may not be living his dream, but don't we at least share his dream? And what better evidence could there be than the fact that we have just re-elected our nation's first black president, something that was nearly unimaginable in 1963 or 1968? What better evidence could there be than that beautiful, multiracial, multi-ethnic gathering in the Mall of Washington, D.C. we witnessed today and broadcast around the world? Clearly, we're living the dream, or at least sharing the dream, right? It has been said by numerous philosophers and theologians that any society, any civilization, must be judged by how it treats its most vulnerable members and its prisoners. King no doubt would agree with that assessment. And in considering how we fare in that regard, I find myself thinking of people like Susan Burton, people who have cycled in and out of our nation's prison system in this era of mass incarceration, in this post-King, post-civil rights era, a time when our prison population has more than quintupled, and millions of people, overwhelmingly poor people of color, are now permanently locked up and locked out, stripped of the very civil and human rights that Dr. King and so many others risked their lives for, and some even died for. I think of Susan Burton, whose son was killed by the police. A police cruiser barreling down her street in Los Angeles ran over her 5-year-old boy. She received no apology, no acknowledgement of her loss. She fell into a deep, deep depression and unspeakable grief, ultimately becoming addicted to crack cocaine. Now, if Susan had been wealthy, or if she had even just been solidly middle class with a good job and a good health care plan, she would undoubtedly have qualified for many, many hours of therapy and counseling. She would have been entitled to good legal drugs that would have helped her cope with her severe depression and grief. But no, things were different for Susan. Impoverished, living in South Central LA, she had nowhere to turn, and she became addicted to crack cocaine, and thus began her odyssey of cycling in and out of our prison system for 15 years. Never offered drug treatment, only one plea deal after another. Just take the deal. You'll get 3 years rather than 8. You'll get 5 years rather than 12. Just take the deal. Just take the deal. She took one plea deal after another, and each time she was released, tossed out onto the street, no money, nowhere to go, now a drug felon, forced to check the blocks on employment applications, unable to find work anywhere, finding it difficult to survive, and yes, she committed crimes, crimes of survival, crimes to feed her drug addiction, and she cycled in and out for 15 years until, by some small miracle, she was placed in a private drug treatment facility and became clean and was given a job. And she decided from then on that she was going to dedicate the rest of her life to making sure that no other woman would ever have to go through what she went through. And she began by going down to the prison bus where it would drop women prisoners off in Skid Row in Los Angeles, carrying nothing but a cardboard box of containing their belongings and dropping them off onto the street. And she would go down and meet women getting off the prison bus, people who were strangers to her. And she said, come home with me. Come home with me. You can sleep on my couch. You can sleep on my floor. You do not have to turn to the streets tonight. I'll make sure you're safe. I'll make sure you have food. Just come home with me. Susan now runs 5 safe homes for women in Los Angeles, providing employment services, job training, a roof over women's heads. She provides help reunifying children with their children. providing a lifeline for people who had no hope. And beyond that, she is organizing formerly incarcerated people to demand the restitution of their basic civil and human rights, arguing that each and every one of us, each human being, is entitled to basic dignity, humanity, and respect. Clearly, Susan has caught up with King. But what about the rest of us? Now, what I have to say on this point will not be popular. It is not the sunny, cheerful message that is expected on days like today, but I believe it to be the truth. And it implicates me. It implicates everyone in this room, particularly those of us who imagine that we are deeply committed to racial and social justice. And the truth is this: we have allowed a human rights nightmare to occur on our watch. In the years since Dr. King's death, a vast new system of racial and social control has emerged from the ashes of slavery and Jim Crow, a system of mass incarceration that no doubt would have Dr. King turning in his grave today. The mass incarceration of poor people of color in the United States has emerged as a new caste-like system, one that shuttles our youth from decrepit, underfunded schools to brand new high-tech prisons. It is a system that locks poor people, overwhelmingly poor folks of color, into a permanent second-class status, nearly as effectively as earlier systems of control once did. It is, in my view, the moral equivalent of Jim Crow. Now, I am always eager to admit that there was a time when I rejected this kind of talk, that there was a time when I rejected comparisons between mass incarceration and slavery, mass incarceration and Jim Crow, believing that those kinds of claims and comparisons were exaggerations or distortions, even hyperbole. In fact, there was a time when I thought that people who made those kinds of claims and those kinds of comparisons were actually doing more harm than good to efforts to reform our criminal justice system and achieve greater racial equality in the United States. But what a difference a decade makes. For after years of working as a civil rights lawyer and advocate, representing victims of racial profiling and police brutality, and investigating patterns of drug law enforcement in poor communities of color, and attempting to assist people released from prison re-enter into a society that had never shown much use for them in the first place, that I had a series of experiences that began what I call my awakening. I began to awaken to a racial reality that is just so obvious to me now that what seems odd in retrospect is that I, someone who cared about social justice, that I could have been blind to it for so long. As I write in the introduction to my book, what has changed since the collapse of Jim Crow has less to do with the basic structure of our society than the language we use to justify it. In the era of colorblindness, it is no longer socially permissible to use race explicitly as a justification for discrimination, exclusion, and social contempt. So we don't. Rather than rely on race, we use our criminal justice system to label people of color criminals, and then engage in all the practices that we supposedly left behind. Today, it is perfectly legal to discriminate against criminals in nearly all the ways in which it was once legal to discriminate against African Americans. Once you're labeled a felon, the old forms of discrimination, employment discrimination, housing discrimination, denial of the right to vote, exclusion from jury service, suddenly legal. As a criminal, you have scarcely more rights and arguably less respect than a black man living in Alabama at the height of Jim Crow. We have not ended racial caste in America, we have merely redesigned it. Well, here are a few of the facts that I uncovered in the course of my work and research that I describe in the book. More African American adults are under correctional control today, in prison or jail, on probation or parole, than were enslaved in 1850 a decade before the Civil War began. As of 2004, more black men were disenfranchised than in 1870, the year the 15th Amendment was ratified, prohibiting laws that explicitly deny the right to vote on the basis of race. Now, of course, during the Jim Crow era, poll taxes and literacy tests operated to keep black folks from the polls. Well, today, felon disenfranchisement laws accomplish in many states what poll taxes and literacy tests ultimately could not. Now, this isn't a phenomenon that affects some small segment of the African American community. No, to the contrary. In many major urban areas today, more than half of working age African American men now have criminal records and are thus subject to legalized discrimination for the rest of their lives. In cities like Chicago, Baltimore, Philadelphia, I don't know the stats for Nashville, but in major urban areas today, so many of them, the stats are far, far worse. In fact, in Chicago, it was reported that if you take into account prisoners, if you actually count them as people, and, you know, prisoners are excluded from poverty statistics, they're excluded from unemployment data, you know, thus masking the severity of racial inequality in the United States. But if you actually count prisoners as people in the Chicago area, nearly 80% of working age African American men now have criminal records and are thus subject to legalized discrimination for the rest of their lives. These men are part of a growing undercaste, not class, caste, a group of people defined largely by race, relegated to a permanent second-class status by law. Now, I find that when I tell people that I now believe that mass incarceration is like a new Jim Crow, a new caste system, people typically react with shock, disbelief. They say, well, how can you say that? How can you say that? Just look at Barack Obama. You know, just look at Oprah Winfrey. Just look at Colin Powell and Condoleezza Rice, you know. But I think it's important to keep in mind that no caste system in the United States has ever governed all African Americans. There have always been free blacks and extraordinary black success stories, even during slavery and Jim Crow. I mean, during slavery, there were some black slave owners. Not many, but there were some. And during Jim Crow, there were some black lawyers and black doctors. Not many, but there were some. Now, the extraordinary nature of individual black achievement in formerly white domain today certainly does suggest that the old Jim Crow is dead. But it doesn't necessarily mean the end of racial caste. If history is any guide, it may have just taken a different form. I think any honest observer of American racial history has to acknowledge that the rules and reasons the legal system employs for enforcing status relations of any kind, they evolve and they change as they're challenged. In the first chapter of the book, I describe the cyclical rebirths of caste in America. Since our nation's founding, African Americans have repeatedly been controlled through institutions like, you know, slavery and Jim Crow, which appear to die, but then are reborn in new form tailored to the needs and constraints of the time. For example, following slavery, following the Civil War, a new system was born that replaced slavery, known as convict leasing. Many people aren't aware that after the Civil War, black men were arrested en masse. It was our nation's first prison boom. They were arrested, sent to prison, and they were arrested for extremely minor crimes like loitering and vagrancy. Arrested, sent to prison, and then leased to plantations. Sometimes the very plantations they had been freed from or their family members had been freed from. Sometimes they were leased to corporations. Leased to plantations. And the idea was that they were supposed to earn their freedom, but the catch was that they could never earn enough to pay back the plantation owner, you know, the cost of their food, clothing, and shelter to the plantation owner's satisfaction. And so they were effectively re-enslaved, sometimes for the rest of their lives. Douglas Blackman has written an excellent book on the subject of convict leasing entitled Slavery by Another Name. Well, today I believe that the criminal justice system has been used once again in a manner that effectively recreates caste in America. Now, I know there's more than one person right now who's thinking, okay, what is she talking about? Our criminal justice system isn't a system of racial control, it's a system of crime control. And if black folks would just stop running around committing so many crimes, they wouldn't have to worry about being locked up and then stripped of their basic civil and human rights. But therein lies the greatest myth about the system of mass incarceration, namely that it's been driven by crime and crime rates. Just not true. It's not true. Our prison population has more than quintupled. It quintupled within the space of just 30 years. We went from a prison population of about 300,000 to now over 2 million. We now have the highest rate of incarceration in the world, dwarfing the rates of even highly repressive regimes like Russia or China or Iran. But again, this cannot be explained simply by crime or crime rates. During that 30-year period of time when our prison population quintupled, crime rates fluctuated. They went up, went down, went back up again, went back up, went down. Today, as bad as crime rates are nationally, you know, crime rates are actually at historical lows. But incarceration rates have consistently soared. Most criminologists and sociologists today will acknowledge that crime rates and incarceration rates in the United States have moved independently of one another. Incarceration rates, especially black incarceration rates, have soared regardless of whether crime is going up or going down in any given community or the nation as a whole. So what explains this sudden explosion in imprisonment, the birth of a penal system unprecedented in world history, if not crime or crime rates? Well, the answer is the war on drugs and the get tough movement, the wave of punitiveness that washed over the United States. Drug convictions alone, just drug convictions, accounted for about 2/3 of the increase in the federal prison system and more than half of the increase in the state prison system between 1985 and 2000, the period of our prison system's most dramatic expansion. Drug convictions have increased more than 1,000% since the drug war began. I mean, to get a sense of how large a contribution the drug war has made to mass incarceration, consider this. There are more people in prisons and jails today just for drug offenses than were incarcerated for all reasons in 1980. Now, most Americans violate drug laws in their lifetime. They do. You don't have to raise your hands. It's been shown. But the enemy in this war has been racially defined. Not by accident. This drug war has been waged almost exclusively in poor communities of color, even though studies have consistently shown now for decades that, contrary to popular belief, people of color are no more likely to use or sell illegal drugs than whites. Or sell. Now, that defies our basic racial stereotypes about who a drug dealer is. You know, you picture in your mind a drug dealer, and if you're like most Americans, you see some black kid stand on the street corner with his pants sagging down. And plenty of drug dealing happens in the hood, but it happens everywhere else in America as well. A white kid living in rural Tennessee doesn't drive to the hood to get his marijuana or his meth or his cocaine. No. He gets it most likely from someone of his own race down the road. Drug dealing happens in all communities of all colors, including college campuses. I remember, I went here. It happens here too. It happens in communities of all colors. But those who do time for drug crime are overwhelmingly black and brown. In some states, 80 to 90% of all drug offenders sent to prison have been one race, African American. Now, I find that very often when people see this data, they say, oh, you know, that's a shame, you know, but we need a war on them. those people. We need to get tough on them, because that's where the violent offenders, that's where the drug kingpins are. We need to get tough on them. But what many people don't realize is this drug war has never been focused primarily on rooting out the violent offenders or drug kingpins. It's just not true. Federal funding in this war has flowed to those state and local law enforcement agencies that boost the sheer numbers of drug arrests. It's been a numbers game. Law enforcement agencies have been awarded in cash for the sheer numbers of people swept into the system for drug offenses, which helps to explain why police officers so often go out looking for the so-called low-hanging fruit, stopping, frisking, searching as many people as possible in an effort to boost their numbers, to get their numbers up. And to make matters worse, federal drug forfeiture laws allow state and local law enforcement agencies to keep for their own use up to 80% of the cash, cars, homes seized from suspected drug offenders. You don't have to be convicted, just suspected. Law enforcement can take your cash off of you, take your car, sell it. Proceeds go to the department, thus giving law enforcement a direct monetary interest, not in ending drug abuse or drug addiction or even drug-related crime, but in the longevity of this war itself. And the results are predictable. The overwhelming majority of people swept in to the criminal justice system for drug offenses have been arrested for relatively minor, nonviolent drug offenses. In 2005, for example, 4 out of 5 drug arrests were for simple possession. Only 1 out of 5 were for sales. Most people in state prison for drug offenses today have no history of violence or even significant selling activity. And in the 1990s, the period of the greatest escalation of the drug war, nearly 80% of the increase in drug arrests were for marijuana possession, a drug that has been shown to be less harmful, less addictive than alcohol or tobacco, and at least, if not more prevalent, in middle-class white communities and on college campuses as it is in the hood. But by waging this drug war almost exclusively in the poorest communities, communities defined by race and class, we have created a vast new racial undercaste in an astonishingly short period of time. Millions of people, tens of millions of people, cycling in and out of our criminal justice system today. Now, where is the U.S. Supreme Court in all of this? Where is the U.S. Supreme Court? Well, far from vigilantly defending the rights of the accused, rights of racial minorities, the U.S. Supreme Court has been busy in recent years eviscerating Fourth Amendment protections against unreasonable searches and seizures, allowing the police the authority to stop, frisk, search anyone, anywhere without a shred of evidence of reasonable suspicion or probable cause as long as they get consent. And what is consent? When a police officer walks up to a young man with his hand on his gun and says, "Son, put your arms up in the air, will you, so I can search you, see if you got anything on you?" Kid says, "Uh-huh." That's consent. And he just waived his Fourth Amendment rights against unreasonable searches and seizures. Not a shred of evidence is necessary for that encounter. And these encounters aren't isolated. They happen over and over again. The New York City Police Department reported that in 1 year alone, just 1 year, its police officers in 1 year stopped and frisked 600,000 people. 1 year alone. Overwhelmingly black and brown men. But the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled that we cannot challenge these racial disparities in a court of law. In a series of cases beginning with McCleskey versus Kemp and Armstrong versus the United States, the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled that it doesn't matter how overwhelming your statistical evidence of discrimination might be. It doesn't matter how severe the racial disparities are. Unless you can offer proof of conscious intentional bias, tantamount to an admission by an officer, you can't even state a claim for race discrimination in our criminal justice system today. So many of the racial profiling cases that I was bringing a decade ago can't even be filed in a court of law today. The U.S. Supreme Court has closed the courthouse doors to claims of racial bias at every stage of the criminal justice process, from stops and searches to plea bargaining and sentencing. Unless you have proof of conscious intentional bias tantamount to an admission, you can't even state a claim. Now, of course, that is precisely the kind of evidence that's nearly impossible to come by in this so-called era of colorblindness, when law enforcement, like the rest of us, know better than to state their racial biases out loud. Police officer is not likely to say to the judge, "Well, yes, Your Honor, the reason I stopped him was, well, because he was black." It's not likely to say that. A prosecutor is not likely to say, "Well, yes, Your Honor, I would have given him a better plea deal, or I would have given him a second chance, maybe even dismiss the case, but, you know, the kid seems like he is no good. I mean, he black kid from that neighborhood." No. Most law enforcement officials, like the rest of us, know better than to state our racial biases and stereotypes out loud, but more importantly, so many of the biases and stereotypes that drive law enforcement decision-making operate on such an unconscious level that many well-meaning, well-intentioned law enforcement officials can't even admit to themselves their biases if they tried. Police officers seeing a group of young black men walking down the street with their pants sagging might think, "Oh, let me jump out, frisk them, see what they're up to, and do my job." Same officer would see a group of young white kids walking down the street, the thought would never even cross their mind, jump out, frisk them, have them lying spread eagle on the sidewalk. Now, that officer may not be meaning those black youth any harm. He may have good intentions. But those discretionary bias stereotype decisions play out over and over again, hundreds of thousands of times in just one city, adding up to enormous racial disparities that the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled we cannot even challenge in a court of law. In this way, the U.S. Supreme Court has immunized the system of mass incarceration from judicial scrutiny for racial bias, much in the same way that the U.S. Supreme Court once rallied to defend slavery and Jim Crow in their day. But of course, just being swept into the system with little hope of being able to challenge the bias or the tactics that were used to get you in the door is just the beginning of your odyssey, because once you're branded a criminal or a felon, you're ushered into a parallel social universe in which the basic civil and human rights that the rest of us may take for granted no longer apply to you. You may be denied the right to vote for a period of years or the rest of your life, depending on the state you're in. You're deemed ineligible for jury service for the rest of your life. Employment discrimination is now legal against you. For the rest of your life, you've got to check that box on employment applications asking that dreaded question, "Have you ever been convicted of a felony?" It doesn't matter if that felony happened a few weeks ago, a few months ago, or 45 years ago. The rest of your life, checking that box, knowing full well the odds are sky high that application's going straight to the trash. Many people say, "Oh, come on, don't make excuses for people. I mean, it's hard when you get out of prison, but if you try, you really try to find a job, you could do it. You've just got to try. I mean, you could get a job at McDonald's or something." Getting a job at McDonald's is no easy feat if you have a felony record. People say, "Well, maybe they could be entrepreneurs or start their own businesses." I say, "Well, when you get out of prison, you don't have a lot of money to invest, but even if you did, hundreds of professional licenses are off limits to people branded criminals. In fact, in my state, in Ohio, you can't even get a license to be a barber once you've been convicted of a felony. What are you expected to do? Housing discrimination, legal, perfectly routine against you if you have a criminal record. Public housing projects, as well as private landlords, free to discriminate against you and routinely do. Public benefits may be denied to you, perfectly legal. In fact, under federal law, you may be denied food stamps. It's a federal law authorizing the denial of food stamps to people convicted of drug felonies. Now, fortunately, many states have now opted out of the federal ban on food stamps for people convicted of drug offenses, but it remains the case that thousands of people can't even get food stamps, can't even get food, because they were once caught with drugs. What do we expect people to do? You're released from prison, tossed on the street, can't get a job. Housing is off limits to you? You may not even qualify for food stamps to survive? Well, apparently what we expect people to do is to pay hundreds or thousands of dollars in fees, fines, court costs, accumulated back child support, which continues to accrue while you're in prison. And in a growing number of states, you're actually expected to pay back the costs of your imprisonment. And paying back all these fees, fines, and court costs may be a condition of your probation or parole. And then get this, if you're one of the lucky few, the very few, who manages to get a job right out of prison, up to 100% of your wages can be garnished. 100%. To pay back all those fees, fines, court costs, accumulated back child support. What do we expect folks to do? I think the better question is, when you take a step back and view the system as a whole, what does it seem designed to do? It seems designed, in my view, to send folks right back to prison, which is what, in fact, happens the vast majority of the time. About 70% of people released from prison return within a few years, and the majority of those who return in some states do so in a matter of months because the challenges associated with mere survival on the outside are so immense. So what do we do? What do we do? Well, my own view is that nothing short of a major social movement has any hope for ending mass incarceration and inspiring a recommitment to Dr. King's dream. Now, if you doubt that such a movement is necessary, if you think surely something less than a full-blown movement will do, consider this. If we were to return to the rates of incarceration we had in the 1970s or the early 1980s before the war on drugs and the Get Tough movement really kicked off, we would have to release 4 out of 5 people who are in prison today. 4 out of 5. More than 1 million people employed by the criminal justice system would lose their jobs. Most new private and public prisons have been constructed in predominantly white rural communities that are often quite vulnerable economically, and many of these communities have been sold on prisons as an answer to their economic woes, providing jobs, much-needed jobs for these communities. And quite often, you know, those who are trying to build prisons offer communities far more benefits than they actually deliver, but nonetheless, you have whole communities now that have come to believe that they depend on prisons for their survival. Those prisons across America would have to close down. Private prison companies now listed on the New York Stock Exchange and doing quite well in a time of economic recession, those companies would be forced to go belly up, go bankrupt. This system is now so deeply rooted in our social, political, and economic structure that it's not going to just fade away. It's not going to just downsize out of sight without a major upheaval, a fairly radical shift in our public consciousness. Now, I know that there are many people today who will tell me that, oh, you know, there is no hope of ending mass incarceration in America. Just as many people in the South were resigned to Jim Crow and would say, yeah, it's a shame. It's a shame, but that's just the way that it is. I find that so many people today find the millions cycling in and out of our prisons and jails is just an unfortunate but inalterable fact of American life. Well, I am certain that Dr. King would not be so easily deterred. So I believe that if we are going to honor Dr. King, truly honor him, try to catch up with him, we have got to be willing to pick up where he left off and do the hard work of movement building on behalf of poor people of all colors. We must. In 1968, Dr. King told advocates that the time had come to transition from a civil rights movement to a human rights movement, Meaningful equality could not be achieved through civil rights alone. Basic human rights must be honored. The right to work, the right to housing, the right to quality education. Without basic human rights, he said, civil rights are an empty promise. So in honor of Dr. King and all those who labor to end the old Jim Crow, I will hope we will commit ourselves to building a human rights movement to end mass incarceration, a movement for education, not incarceration, for jobs, not jails, a movement to end all these forms of legal discrimination against people released from prison, discrimination that denies them basic human rights to work, to shelter, to food. Now, what must we do to begin this movement? To build upon the work that already has been done? Well, first, we've got to be willing to tell the truth, the whole truth. We have got to be willing to admit out loud that we as a nation have managed to recreate a caste-like system in this country. And we've got to be willing to tell this truth in our schools, in our places of worship. We've got to be willing to tell this truth inside prisons and in reentry centers. We've got to be willing to tell this truth so that a great awakening can begin. Unlike the old Jim Crow, there are no signs posted anywhere alerting you to the existence of this new caste-like system. Back then, there were whites-only signs leaving no doubt about the caste system that was firmly in place. But today, prisons are out of sight, out of mind. The people who cycle in and out of prisons typically cycle in and out of segregated communities, far away from the mainstream middle class, cycling in and out, outside anyone's conscious awareness among all those who have jobs, live in decent neighborhoods, and zoom around on freeways past the literal and virtual prisons in which they live. So if we are to challenge this system of mass incarceration, build a human rights movement that will ultimately end it, we have got to be willing to speak uncomfortable and inconvenient truths, to make visible what has been hidden in plain sight for far too long. We've got to be willing to pull back the curtain and dispel the myths and rationalizations that sustained this system for far too long. But of course, just a lot of talk isn't going to be enough. It's necessary, but it's not going to be enough. We've also got to be willing to get to work. In my view, that means we have got to be willing to build an underground railroad for people released from prison. An underground railroad helping people to shuttle from prison. People who are trying to make a genuine break for real freedom. Help people find jobs, places of work, find shelter, food, get a roof over their head. We need an army of people who are willing to say, no, you are not forgotten. We are willing to open our arms, we're willing to open our hearts to you and actually welcome you home. And if you are willing to work for real freedom, we are willing to march right there with you. We've got to create safe places for people returning home from prison and their family members who are struggling to survive in this era of mass incarceration. How do we create safe places? Well, I think first, we've got to be willing to admit our own criminality out loud. Our own criminality. Because the reality is that we've all made mistakes. Some big, perhaps some small. We've all made mistakes. We're all sinners. We've all done wrong in our lives. And all of us are criminals. The adults in this room, you've broken the law at some point in your lives. Maybe you drank underage or experimented with drugs, or if the worst thing you've ever done in your whole life is speed 10 miles over the speed limit on the freeway, you've put yourself and others at more risk of harm than someone smoking marijuana in the privacy of their living room. That is the truth. That's the truth. But there are people in the United States today
serving life sentences for first-time drug offenses. Life sentences. The U.S. Supreme Court upheld life sentences for first-time drug offenders against an Eighth Amendment challenge that such a sentence was cruel and unusual punishment in violation of the Eighth Amendment. And the U.S. Supreme Court said, no, it's not cruel and unusual to sentence a young man to life in prison for a first-time drug offense, even though virtually no other country in the world does such a thing. So we've got to stop this idea that the criminals are them, not us, and say, there, but for the grace of God, go I. But for my privilege. But for my privilege of whatever kind, racial privilege or class privilege or being lucky enough just not to get caught. Because of my privilege, I am not cycling in and out along with them. After all, President Barack Obama has admitted to more than a little bit of drug use in his youth. He's admitted to using marijuana and cocaine. And if Obama had not been raised by white grandparents in Hawaii, and if he hadn't done most of his drug use on predominantly white college campuses and universities, if he had been raised in the hood, the odds are very good. He would have been stopped, he would have been frisked, he would have been searched, he would have been caught, and far, far, far from being president of the United States today, he might not even have the right to vote, depending on what state he lives in. So we have got to recognize that what this movement is about is saving our young people, saving all of us. This is about building a movement on behalf of all of us. All of us have made mistakes, done wrong in our lives, but only some of us are forced to pay for those mistakes for the rest of our lives. But just building an underground railroad isn't going to be enough either. Because in the days of slavery, you know, it wasn't enough to just shuttle a few to freedom one by one, opening hearts, opening homes one by one. You had to be willing to work for abolition. Well, today we have got to be willing to work for the abolition of this system of mass incarceration as a whole. We do. And that means ending the war on drugs once and for all. Yes. We have spent $1 trillion waging the drug war since it began. $1 trillion just on the war on drugs. We're constantly being told we don't have enough money to pay our teachers. We don't have enough money for small class sizes. We don't have enough money for jobs programs for our youth in the summertime. We don't have enough money for this and for that. But apparently we had $1 trillion to blow. And we spent it building prisons and jails and monitoring millions as they cycled in and out. We've spent $1 trillion, arrested more than 40 million people in the drug war, and yet rates of drug addiction and drug abuse remain largely unchanged. Illegal drugs are as widely available and cheaper than they were when the drug war began. It's time to end the madness and shift to a public health model for dealing with drug addiction and drug abuse and stop wasting millions of dollars and lives. And we've also got to end all these forms of legal discrimination against people released from prison. These forms of discrimination that deny them basic human rights to work, to shelter, to food, to survive. And last but not least, we've got to shift from a purely punitive approach to dealing with violence and violent crime in our communities to a more rehabilitative and restorative approach, one that takes seriously the interests of the victim, the offender, and the community as a whole. We have got a lot of work to do. And if it seems like too much, if it seems like it can't possibly be done, keep in mind this. All of these rules, laws, policies, practices that comprise this system of mass incarceration, they all rest upon one core belief. And it's the same core belief that sustained Jim Crow. It's the belief that some of us are not worthy of genuine care, compassion, or concern. And when we effectively challenge that core belief, this whole system begins to fall like dominoes. A multiracial, multi-ethnic human rights movement must be born, when rooted in the recognition of the dignity and humanity of all people. And it's got to be multiracial and multi-ethnic. Although this war on drugs may have been born with black folks in mind, it is a war that has destroyed the lives of people in communities of all colors. And the same divisive, get-tough politics that gave birth to mass incarceration and the drug war, those same kinds of politics are birthing another prison-building boom, this one aimed at suspected illegal immigrants. So we have got to be willing to connect the dots and build a multiracial, multi-ethnic movement on behalf of all of us. But before this movement can truly get underway, a great awakening is required. We have got to awaken from this colorblind slumber we've been in to the realities of race in America. And we've got to be willing to embrace those labeled criminals. Not necessarily all their behavior, but them, their humanness. For it is the refusal and failure to recognize the dignity and humanity of all people that has been the sturdy foundation for every caste system that has ever existed in the United States or anywhere else in the world. It's our task, I firmly believe, to end not just mass incarceration, not just the war on drugs, but to end this history and cycle of caste in America. Then and only then can we say with pride that we are truly catching up to King. Thank you so much for having me tonight. Thank you. Thank you.
Can we build a human rights movement? Can we build an underground railroad system? Can we build abolitionism once again? Can we confront segregation when three strikes means we don't want to live with you, we don't want to work with you, we don't want to worship with you? Can we build a human rights movement? There are two microphones in the back of each aisle, one on the back of each aisle here. We have just a few minutes for you to perhaps ask your own question. Please bear with us as I ask you to form a question rather than a narrative, if you will. We have only an opportunity for a few questions, so your conciseness is important. We'll start to my right.
This is difficult to do it without a narrative, but if we placed our emphasis on reducing recidivism in Tennessee, which has a 46% return rate, we would save $23 million a year. And I represent the Tennessee Consultation on Criminal Justice. I will hand you our recommendations to show you what we are doing, because Tip O'Neill said all politics is local. I would like you to just comment on that. If anyone wants to join what we are doing in the Tennessee Consultation on Criminal Justice, I will share this with you for your information, but then invite others if they're interested to know what they can do, because saving money sells to conservatives. And we will save a lot of money if we do this, because we can reduce recidivism from our 46% rate to maybe as low as Oregon's, which is in the 28% rate. That would save millions of dollars, and that will sell to conservatives. Please comment.
Well, thank you, and I'm thrilled to hear of the work you are doing to reduce recidivism. And I agree strongly that building this movement begins on a local level. This has got to be bottom up. We are not going to have a top-down movement. And as much as I would like to imagine that President Barack Obama will not only end the war on drugs, but will also declare that we need to repeal all of the federal laws that authorize legal discrimination against people released from prison, I'm not going to hold my breath for that. And the truth is that even if he were to make such a sweeping statement, a sweeping decree, if the public, if we hadn't built a new moral consensus that poor people of color, poor people of all colors deserve to be treated with basic dignity and humanity, we might manage to scale down or end one system, but a new one would be born again. A new one would surely be born. And so our challenge, I think, is much more than simply policy reform. It truly is about building a new moral consensus, changing people's, not only their minds about what makes rational policy, but changing their hearts, being willing to open their hearts. And that was, after all, Dr. King's goal, was to change the heart, to save the soul of America, not simply to shift policy. And I think that has got to be our ultimate goal as well. And it is for that reason that I don't ever say that we should make these changes and these policy reforms because they will save money, even when I'm talking to a conservative audience. And it's because we need to make these changes because they're the right thing to do. They're the morally right thing to do. And these are human beings, they're not commodities, and their value cannot be measured in dollars and cents. And so certainly, when you are trying to make policy change of any kind, it can be useful to point out that it's not necessarily going to cost you more money to do the right thing. But for me personally, I will not be advertising that this is a way to save money. In fact, my own view is that every penny that is saved from locking people up and warehousing them in prisons must be reinvested back into the very communities that have been decimated by mass incarceration. People talk to me about the, you know, we need reparations for slavery, we need reparations for Jim Crow. I say, okay, well, what about reparations for the war on drugs? What about reparations for mass incarceration? You know, we have real needs in our community that are going to be expensive. And Dr. King would often remind people that the changes that lie ahead after the civil rights battle were won, the changes that lie ahead, restructuring our society to ensure that every child, rich and poor, has quality education, it's not going to come on the cheap. So saving money cannot be the reason for making these changes. Because undoing the harm that has been done may well prove quite expensive. So let's ensure that we are arguing that we want to do the right things for the right reasons and try to forge a new moral consensus and just not save folks some money.
To my left.
Really appreciate your scholarship and movement. Dr. Charles C. McIntyre also captures the essence of your thesis this evening. Two-part question. One, can you mention about how there's a strong prediction of looking at test scores of kids when they're in elementary school and predicting your central theme of how African Americans are disproportionately placed into prisons in the future by the time they enter in their teenage years? And second, how did you see from your last comment and your presentation how all of this system is so rooted in capitalism that this group of people who have this system that is going on is fundamentally making billions of dollars from the industry of incarceration? Thank you.
Thank you. Great questions. And, you know, first, you know, I have heard from a number of different sources that policymakers are making estimates about how many prison beds they will need in the future based on, you know, third grade or fourth grade reading scores. And, you know, these reports are very disturbing, to say the least. And I find that many people assume that this means that if we just improve our education system, then mass incarceration will go away. And I don't think it's quite that simple. And the reason is this. We've always had bad schools in African American communities. This is not new. Poverty in black communities is not new. Illiteracy in the black community is not new. Mass incarceration is new. It's brand new. So I think we have to resist the temptation to imagine that mass incarceration is caused by poverty or bad schools. No, it's not caused by poverty or bad schools. Instead, mass incarceration is our chosen response to poor people and people who are undereducated in this country. And I think the distinction is important. Now, I think another reason those quotes and those reports are significant is that it reflects that we live in a changed time. It used to be that you didn't have to graduate from high school in order to be able to get a decent job that would support yourself and a family. But thanks to deindustrialization and globalization, what William Julius Wilson calls the disappearance of work in urban areas, now you need a high school diploma, maybe a college degree, in order to get a good job. And so what those reading scores tell you, if you're a policymaker and, you know, in the business of building prisons, what those reading scores tell you is here's the population, here are the numbers of people we have already decided are disposable. Here are the children that we have chosen not to invest in education. Here are the children and the families for whom we have already written off. And that is why those numbers are an indicator. Not because bad schools cause mass incarceration, but because as a society, we have chosen to end a war on poverty, declare a war on drugs, and dispose of a population defined largely by race and class, which is now deemed unnecessary to the functioning of the U.S. economy. Black men no longer needed to pick cotton in the fields, labor in factories, can now be hauled off to droves in prisons and put to work there. And few in our capitalist economy find themselves missing them. So I think that your point about capitalism is well taken. And, you know, I will say this. This is another place where it bodes well to study how Dr. King changed in the years from 1963 to 1968. By 1968, he was asking very serious questions about our economic system. He was demanding economic justice and wondering aloud how a system that cares only about profits or cares more about profits than people could possibly honor the dignity and humanity of all of us. And I think that if we are to pick up where Dr. King left off, it's time we ask ourselves some serious questions about our economic system and whether it is consistent with the dignity and humanity of all of us. Now, that's not to say that King or anyone else endorsed socialism or communism or any other ism. It was about searching for new models, searching for new ways of ensuring that whatever economic system we design is one that truly honors the basic dignity and humanity of all of us and doesn't view anyone as disposable.
We have time for only two more very brief questions here, and then we'll go to this mic as well.
Thank you, Professor Alexander. I'm from Newark, New Jersey. My question to you is, how do you justify the outrage of the tragic suicide of a 26-year-old computer prodigy who family said was intimidated by federal prosecutors, might spend 6 months in jail I know brothers that spend a year or more in the county jail just waiting to go to trial. I just would like your reaction on that.
Yeah, I have to say I've been surprised, though perhaps I shouldn't be. I've been surprised by how little attention has been given to the fact that what he faced as a young man, many ways pales in by comparison to what so many young men face for what are considered minor crimes. And he was driven to suicide. Lawrence Lessig, who was once a professor at Stanford and I now believe is at Harvard, wrote an excellent blog piece a while ago in which he talked about reflecting on the case and the suicide, and he pointed out that, you know, this young man actually was threatened by prosecutors, as is typical, that, you know, he would potentially face decades or more behind bars if he dared take this case to trial. But what scared the young man most wasn't the time behind bars. What scared him most, Professor Lessig said, was the fear of being labeled a felon for the rest of his life. That he was willing to do the prison time, but he couldn't bear being branded a felon for the rest of his life. And I thought to myself, why aren't we talking about why we subject so many people, millions of people, to this, and why we're so outraged over this young man's treatment, but we can't muster a peep of concern about the millions of young black and brown folks who face that reality every day and who get barely a mention in the evening news. So thank you very much for your question and concern.
Hello, Professor.
Hi.
I'm from Los Angeles, and it is widely thought that in one fairly well-to-do black area there, that drugs were brought in, I'm not sure by whom, Colombia or a Mexican drug lord or whoever it was, back in the day. I'm not even sure if it was 20 years ago or when. And it was specifically dropped in that community for the purpose of the black community taking hold of those drugs, using them, and becoming addicted. I'd like to know if you know whether it's any city, any particular state, any area, that that's been shown to be true. And also, the second part of this question is, where would the drug, where would the rehab begin, in your opinion, if there was going to be a fight against, you know, the imprisonment of these young men? What city should it begin in?
Okay, great questions. Yes, you know, there, that's a big question, so I'm trying to figure out how to do this concisely. If you're interested in learning more about the allegations that the CIA actually knew about, you know, Nicaraguan cartels that were smuggling drugs into Los Angeles, I recommend reading Gary Webb's book, Dark Alliance. Gary Webb was a San Jose Mercury News reporter who received some tips and information about how the CIA had knowledge of the smuggling of illegal drugs and was remaining silent and perhaps even assisting to some extent because it was perceived as in our national security interests at the time, given the war that was going on in Nicaragua. And he did an enormous amount of research and investigation and published a series in the San Jose Mercury News exposing the CIA's knowledge and complicity in the drug smuggling into Los Angeles. And he received so much criticism for even making that allegation that the San Jose Mercury News ultimately decided to fire him. And he continued his investigation and his research for years, ultimately publishing the book Dark Alliance, but remained hounded and received all kinds of threats and later committed suicide. But what's interesting is that the CIA eventually admitted that it had knowledge that Nicaraguan
rebels were smuggling drugs into South Central Los Angeles. So that is a matter of public record that the CIA had knowledge and did nothing to block it. But as far as I know, there has been no evidence shown that the CIA did so with the intent of destroying the black community in South Central LA. They were just willing to stand aside and allow this drug dealing to occur and not intervene because they perceived it as in their interests. So that is different than the CIA or any other government seeking the destruction of the black community because it wanted to destroy the black community. But on the other hand, the result, of course, is the same, which is the government could have prevented what ended up becoming, you know, a devastating epidemic and chose not to intervene. I'm now forgetting the second part of your question.
What city or state would you think would be the first one to...
Nashville. Needs to start in every city and in every state. There isn't any one place that's more important than the rest. We got to start right where we are. So, thank you.
Let us come together to thank Professor Alexander. King ended his life with an appeal that we need to continue to work on racism, materialism, and militarism. We can add in the contortions of a society dreadfully close to recreating apartheid, penal institutionalism. On your arrival, you were handed candles so that we may help form one mind, one spirit, one commitment to coming together to create a movement of human rights. We need to thank Michelle Alexander for her critical gifts to extend a lantern to illumine a path lost to us in the work of freedom. The face of racism mutates, and what we intended to be its tomb often becomes its womb, to reemerge in destructive creations, to assault the freedom of our humanity anew. And so we raise our troubled torches with her in the bewilderment of the night and commit ourselves to blaze that path rediscovered. Thank you, Vanderbilt University and this Nashville community, for coming together to celebrate the legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. When we gather together to celebrate the path trod by the sacrifices and agency of so many behind us, and to discern critically the course that lies before us, we live into that legacy of freedom. Freedom is among our most cherished values. Care for the freedom of another is among our most ardent calls to citizenship and abiding faith. The light of that call must guide us on this path. We invite you to raise together your light, to form a candelabra, to shine on our path as we rediscover how far we have strayed when we criminalize any community and pathologize a people. When race remains a lens of rancor and not restoration, when race is a target of suspicion and not reconciliation, we need to raise a light of liberation to a better path still, where freedom is a right to life and a tenet of faithfulness. We may not be able to draw water from a rock in the desert, or yet clot the blood that flows from dehumanizing stones of hate meant only to sharpen swords of denial. But we may come together with lanterns and agency, candles and commitments, with sparks and fireworks, and raise an indistinguishable flame of hope and salvation for humanity in a freedom that draws sweet honey from that rock of our faiths called together, charged even to the renewal of freedom for a generation imprisoned by our blindness. Silence is not peace. Join us in bursting the silent bubbles that constrain us. Join us in spirit and in song. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. Join us. We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot
rest.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Until the killing of black men,
black
mothers, sons,
is as important as the killing of
white men, white mother's sons. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Ooh, yeah, that which touches me most is that I had a chance to work with people, passing on to others that which was passed on to me. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, like an unchecked cancer, hate corrodes the personality. Hate destroys humanity's sense of values and objectivity. It causes humanity to describe the beautiful as ugly and the ugly as beautiful. Striving to resist the dulling of our senses, to hunger for justice and to cry freedom, join us as we sing.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
Like an unchecked cancer, hate also corrodes our democratic values and undermines our vision for citizenship, committed to transforming institutions blemished in years past by hate. We join in the hymn of the laborer for justice as we sing.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
King once said, the ultimate measure of humanity is not where we stand in moments of comfort and convenience, but where we stand at times of challenge and controversy, motivated into restlessness by those who suffer from the abuses of power and the perpetuation of privilege. We sing.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest until justice becomes the legacy of the oppressed and the priority of the oppressor. Change, though slow, will come for those sleeping in concrete cells, those with criminal records stigmatized by our criminal justice system. But first, we need to burst the silent bubbles that perpetuate injustice. Those forgotten behind concrete walls and steel doors, these and others are our brothers and sisters in need of our voice, our indignation, our witness.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. To me, young people come first.
They come first.
They have the courage where we fail. And if I can but shed some light as they carry us through the gale. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
O God, who has created your children to be free, we attest in word and deed that you are our God and we are your people. From our earliest days, as the people whom you intend to be free, you have called us forth from self-seeking bondage in the form of comfort, complacency, silence, complaint, to freeing and redeeming action for justice everywhere in the world, knowing that belief without action, faith without works, is dead. With restless voices, we sing.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
O God of Exodus and the burning bush, God of Muhammad and Jesus of Nazareth, God of all ancient and modern prophets, we hear you powerfully calling to us to be in service to all of those who are oppressed. We hear your voice in the cries of the hungry, the imprisoned, and the broken, for you made yourself one with those who seek justice, freedom, and peace. Desiring to align ourselves with your call to seek justice, freedom, and peace, we sing out.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
O God, our sustainer, search our hearts and reveal to us our sinfulness, all the ways that we contribute to the injustice and to self and other destroying bondage. Give us deep courage to find the true path of your way, ready to give our very selves as living sacrifices for freedom for all. Awaken us from what Michelle Alexander calls a long slumber of indifference to the poor and vulnerable. We who believe in freedom cannot rest so long as bondage, racism, and oppression exist in any era, in any form. We cannot rest until a system as powerful as our criminal justice system defends the freedom of all people rather than defending some people out of the fear of another. Until all forms of legalized discrimination are put to an end, we sing.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
We have heard you calling. Hear us now as we make our pledge.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
When the last strains of song have passed from breath to echo, when this body of believers has dispersed into corporeal multiplicity, when this moment has passed from present glory to fond recollection, only then shall we know if the gravity of our task provokes us to something more than easy promises and vague platitudes. We stand here almost 45 years and 214 miles removed from the time and space of a Memphis balcony, where the cold hand of murder ripped life from the heart of a man who dared to pursue freedom and justice for even the least of these. In these halls of power and privilege, we have borne witness to the persistent struggle against an injustice whose face is constantly transforming. As we depart, it is our duty to not only confront social ills, but also to address our own complicity, our lackadaisical attitudes towards lasting change, our lackluster efforts in naming daily instances of violent rupture in the fabric of our own communities in Vanderbilt, Nashville, Tennessee, the South, this nation, and even this world. Freedom will not fall passively into our arms like so much manna from the heavens. It will spring from the fertile ground of hearts that have been broken up and overturned. It will emerge from those silent bubbles that are burst open by a muscular empathy. We must stoke the flames of freedom in a world that has rehearsed the words of King far more than it has lived out the hopes of his vision. We must labor to turn our swords into plowshares and cease the shedding of blood that dampens our streets and our spirits. We must cast a revealing light on the pre-existing condition of moral failure that lurks beneath the postmodern, post-racial rhetoric of our day. We must embody the perfected love that casts out all fear and brings us into the knowledge that our survival depends on one another. And though our finite lives and mortal bodies will one day rest among ashes and dust, in this moment, I invite you to rise to your feet and to join us in song as we sing and march out together, echoing those familiar strains. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
Say we who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Ooh, yeah, we who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Yeah, we who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
rest until it come. Ooh, we who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
Good to do this with you guys. Thank you for this opportunity.